And we are live, and let's test the sound.
Yep,
So
let's
hopefully the
see.
sound is still great, and hopefully we are at the same level. So with me is Thomas. Let's test the audio a bit to see
Okay,
how we sound.
I hope we are okay. Tried to test it beforehand, but let's see. This
We sound
works.
equally loud. And for this, we should maybe speak.
Yeah, that's true.
Good morning.
So what do we I'm currently seeing that I have some issues here outside of Zoom.
Yeah, we are just arranging windows and preparing for today. Really excited about it. There will be some improv and plot twists. And we are already sharing
Yeah.
the document here, so with some icebreaker questions. Which tool are people using?
For
Which
code
are
testing.
you, both for testing but also from workshop generally? So of all the things that we showed, what are the things that you are likely to keep using? Which tools do you use for testing code?
And
Because we will demonstrate some of it and then some more questions. So which tools are you using, Thomas?
different since I'm actually not coding Python that much, so at the moment I'm using some JUnit, so for Java code, some VI test for some front end JavaScript stuff. Yeah, different type of testing because a lot of the stuff that I'm currently doing is asynchronous, which makes things slightly annoying.
When did you start testing? Or did you start writing tests when you started writing code, or was that later?
It depends on the project.
No, but I mean more
Some
like in your career.
in my career, way after I started coding. When I actually was at university, code testing was initially not mentioned at all in any of the courses, which in hindsight is, I think, not a good idea because it ha I think it helps writing good code to start to start making code that is tested. Even for smaller things, where the where well, or as soon as what you expect as results are not kind of directly obviously wrong. So as soon as you get situations where, oh, I'm not sure if this is correct or if this is a bug, that's where having your code tested helps a lot. In being confident that this is not due to a bug, but actual results. There are, of course, especially in research situations where it's really, really difficult to test code because you don't necessarily know the results of things, but if you are relatively confident that all parts of what you're doing are okay, then yeah, hopefully the resulting thing at least doesn't have any programmatical bugs. There might still be bugs in the logic. That's the mo those are the most difficult to find, but at least on the programming or on the code side, you can make sure that yeah, all your functions produce the results that you expect them to produce
But that's a
and not
great point
something else.
that sometimes we write a code and we don't know the result yet, so how to approach it, and we will discuss that. And one solution that you mentioned is to then, well, sometimes you don't know what is the result of the whole thing, but you know what the component should be doing, and
Yeah,
then you can
I think
test those.
was it yesterday or is it coming later today, modularized code?
It's later today.
Yeah,
So this will be
that.
the finale where we put all of these things together into one lesson.
Yeah, well, that essentially is a good approach to get smaller units of your code that you can actually test. While you can't really test the whole thing because you don't know the results, but you can test the individual parts to see if they produce what you expect them to produce.
Mm-hmm.
Because there you should at least be able to have some, well, smallish or relatively smallish test data that you can say, okay, well, if I plug this in, this is what I would this is what is to be expected out of it.
Mm-hmm.
And their modularization also helps quite a bit.
So we talked about the past, but also these days, like when you started your project, would you then start with tests from day one or do you add them later? Do you see how it goes?
I mean, it depends. It depends a bit on the type of project and on the size of project. If it's something really, really small, yeah, I sometimes might just skip the tests as well. If it's anything larger, anything a bit more complex, I try to start writing codes early. I'm not personally doing a lot of test-driven development, but that's also an option. So I'm not writing my tests before the actual code most of the time. I have written a few things where, okay, well, I'll write the test and then I write the code and see if my code works or see if I can make that test that should succeed to succeed. But that's something that I would say is for larger collaborative projects where you specify things in the beginning very, very in very much detail so that you can actually say, okay, well, we expect that these parts that you are going to program fulfill these conditions. And those are kind of, that's a good way for a larger collaborative project to work, because you can specify what's expected from each part.
Mm-hmm.
And you can, while doing that specification, already write the tests.
Yeah. I also find it interesting to look back at my approach to testing. So I started doing coding maybe 20 years ago. At the beginning, I didn't know anything about testing. I was just coding. Then maybe 10 years ago, I discovered testing and I thought, wow, that's the way to go. Everything should be tested, otherwise it's not proper code. So I felt I was really dogmatic about it. But now in the recent years, I see it a bit more balanced again. I don't think everything needs to be automated tested automatically. And we will try to have this discussion about when is it needed, when is it not needed. And it really depends. So a code that is not automatically tested, it's not a bad code. It can be still completely correct and working and useful. And it really depends. As you Thomas say, so it really depends on the situation. And these days I approach it much more in a balanced way.
I personally actually think slightly more important than testing is documentation. But at the same time, if you write a good test for your code, that can also be used as documentation for because it's essentially an example of how the code is to be used. So
yeah.
you can combine the two things.
Oh yeah, that's a great point. Let's come back
and,
to that later.
Yeah, so because if you write an example of something, of how your code is to be used, this is essentially a test of your code, and you can more or less directly take that and plug it into, okay, this is a test case.
Yeah.
Because you know what's to expect, what is to be expected out of it, and you can run it. And even if you have research code where you don't initially know the results, but if you publish this, you can use that example script that produces these numbers that you didn't know beforehand.
Yes.
And use them as a test. And that then you at least know that if you change something in the code base afterwards and your test fails, either your original results were wrong because they have now changed, or whatever you changed didn't result in the expected didn't result in the expected behavior.
Great point. Before we go too deep into details, I think it's 9 o'clock in Norway, it's 10 o'clock in Finland, and we are about to start. We will start here in the collaborative document. We have a couple of questions to you to get us started as an icebreaker. Which tools are likely to stick after the workshop? Anything that you discover that you are likely to continue trying out and using would be very nice for us to see. If you are already using any testing in your code, what are the tools that you use? And then please also tell us something about how you participate in this course. And if this was a lot of work, how do you plan to celebrate after the course? And we are together here. So I'm Radovan Bast in Tromsø, Norway. And I will be here co-instructing the two sessions today. And with me is Thomas. Maybe you can say a sentence or two about where you work and what you do.
Yeah, I'm a research software engineer in Aalto, so Finland, Espoo. Helping researchers with coding issues.
Great. And I'm really looking forward to teach this lesson with Thomas to give you a bit of an overview of what to expect today. I will scroll into the session, day six. It's the last course part of the workshop. We have two bonus days if you're interested. The next two Mondays, we want to offer a bring your own code and questions session. I will send an email about it with, so there will be a Zoom room where you can connect and talk with us. This is of course optional, but today is the last really course day. And we have three sessions planned. There will be, the first one is about automated testing. Then after a 1 hour break, we will really put all of this together into a very improvised session about modular code development with Jano. And then we will have a concluding, like an outro session where we tell you a bit where you can go from here. So let's go into automated testing. Let's put the link into the document. Keep the questions coming. Also, questions about the past days are really, really welcome.